It just seemed like it was a scene where Sid was talking a lot, so you could see his teeth, and I was like, hey. I think he's in a hot tub with two lady sloths, and he's like, oh yeah. And I'm like, okay. Hi, I'm Dr. Danielle Fraser. I'm the director of the Beatty Center and research scientist in paleobiology here at the Canadian Museum of Nature. And today I'll be reacting to some Hollywood movies that have Ice Age animals. Well, we're gonna start with 10,000 BC. Here we go. You know, this is probably Mammoth primigenius. This is a species that we had up here in Canada. And in fact, the Canadian Museum of Nature has quite a rich collection of mammoths from the Yukon. And they look pretty accurate in terms of the big domed skull that they had. And interestingly, in our collections, we actually have several skulls that are broken, and you can see, in fact, that they were hollow because these beasts would have struggled carrying such a heavy head if they weren't. They've reconstructed the mammoths as a kind of dark brown, reddish color. This is really common, and that's because when we've found mummies of mammoths in places like Russia, the hair looks really reddish brown. But this actually could be from bacterial and fungal degradation. You know, using ancient DNA, we've actually found that they may have varied in color everywhere from dark brown to almost blonde. So they were just like humans in that sense. Can also see they've reconstructed the mammoths with really nice long curved tusks. This is actually quite accurate. Some interesting things that we have in the collection here include a bunch of mammoth tusks, but one tusk in particular is extremely interesting. This tusk was seized as part of an FBI raid in the US and returned to us after they discovered that it actually came from Canada. So we'll continue on. Humans probably did hunt mammoths, although cut marks are pretty rare on the bones. I'm gonna pause there. Elephants don't gallop. They run with two opposing feet on the ground at all times, and so I think it's really unlikely that mammoths would have moved differently than modern elephants. So I am no Egyptologist, but the oldest pyramid in Egypt is, as far as I know, thousands of years younger than we know that mammoths went extinct. So I think it's very, very unlikely that humans use them as beasts of burden. That being said, environmental DNA coming out of the ground in both the Yukon and places like Russia is suggesting that mammoths and some other Ice Age mammals may have survived longer into the Holocene, maybe to about 5,000 years ago. So here they're showing what I assume is Smilodon, like the specimen right next to me here. Smilodon was a large cat. The Smilodon reconstruction here is perhaps a tad large. As you can see when he's looking face to face with the Smilodon, the head is quite huge. And you can see from the specimen next to me that their heads weren't quite that large. It's accurate in terms of the reconstruction of the really strong forelimbs. Smilodon was probably like modern cats in that it used its forelimbs to grapple with prey as it took them down. So that aspect is accurate. So 10,000 BC is pretty accurate in terms of the animals that it reconstructs as living at the same time as humans. It definitely would have been a terrifying time living with all those megafaunal mammals. So now I'm going to take a look at the movie Alpha. So there's quite a beautiful opening sequence in this movie with a bunch of Ice Age mammals, including mammoths, hyenas, woolly rhinos, and even wolves. This is absolutely fantastic because we know that all of these animals lived on the same landscape at the same time in places like Eurasia. For example, hyenas lived well into Europe during the Pleistocene. This is surprising, of course, because we think of them as African animals. And in fact, hyenas lived in the Yukon in Canada during the Pleistocene. And we have specimens of Pleistocene hyenas here at the Canadian Museum of Nature. So you can also see some really cool animals in this opening sequence, including woolly rhinos. So these animals belong to a genus called Coelodonta. They were big, large-bodied rhinoceroses covered in hair. Interestingly, they never occurred in North America, but I'm hoping that when we go to the field this summer in the Yukon, that we can find some woolly rhino. I still think it's out there. Although we don't see bison commonly on the landscape today, they used to be incredibly numerous and they lived throughout North America and Eurasia. In Canada, we had the steppe bison. We found them in the Yukon, for example, living in the mammoth steppe. And bison were part of the many species of large mammal that went extinct at the end of the last ice age. So all of the species of bison except for one went extinct about 12,000 years ago. An interesting fact, you can actually see in ice cores that time period when those animals went extinct. So scientists have gone and measured methane in the air bubbles and ice cores from places like Greenland. And you can actually see a methane decrease when you start losing the large animals like the bison. And now before you think I'm talking about things that come out the back end, I'm actually mostly talking about burps because species like bison actually do a lot more burping. So here we can see wolves. These are Canis lupus. So in North America, wolves have been present for at least 100,000 years. And we have several examples in our collections here at the Canadian Museum of Nature of wolves, particularly from the late Pleistocene of the Yukon. Wolves are incredibly interesting because they're one of the few large-bodied species that survived that extinction that happened 12,000 years ago that I talked about earlier. And so we are really interested in how did wolves survive this extinction? Why wolves? Why not some of these species that went extinct? And so we use stable isotopes to study their diets. Stable isotopes are chemical tracers that you can find in your bones and teeth that basically tell us what you ate over your entire lifetime. And we found that during the Pleistocene, wolves actually ate a lot of horse. Horses were really common on the landscape at the time, and I'm actually surprised I don't really see any in any of the movies that I'm talking about today. But we found that wolves were eating a lot of horse and then transitioned to eating large deer or cervids today, so things like moose. So that told us that wolves might have been particularly flexible in terms of their diet, and that may have allowed them to survive that extinction event when other species didn't. So I'm no expert in dog domestication by any means. But I had always thought that the scenario was that wolves started spending more time around human settlements because they were gaining some benefit either from the food that humans were giving them or the refuse that were associated with human settlements. And humans enjoyed their presence either as a result of protection or aid in hunting. This particular movie shows a relationship between one human and one wolf, so it may not be trying to represent the story as a whole. One of my favorite things about all of the stories around dog domestication are the memes that have been going around on the internet. They typically show some image of a fierce wolf and then they say 10,000 years later and they show a pug on someone's lap in a clown costume. So I don't think that this cat is Smilodon. I think it's likely to be something like Homotherium. It's really difficult to see because the cat is in the shadow most of the time in this shot. Interestingly, Homotherium was found in both Eurasia and North America, and we have specimens here at the Canadian Museum of Nature. So Homotherium is what is called a scimitar-toothed cat. So it didn't have the large fangs of our Smilodon here, but it still had near saber teeth. And it would have been a formidable hunter. Although it was slightly smaller than Smilodon, I still would be afraid of encountering one of those if they were alive today. So this is a group of incredibly cute puppies at the end of the movie Alpha. And this reminds me of an amazing find from the Yukon, which was a mummified wolf pup, which has been named Jure. So this wolf pup unfortunately died when the den collapsed, but left some amazing evidence of what wolves were doing during the late Pleistocene for scientists. The wolf pup even has all of its hair. And so the scientists were able to go in and use stable isotopes to show that they may actually have been eating a lot of fish, which is not common for wolves, except today in coastal BC, where we see particular groups of wolves that feed almost exclusively on fish and actually do fishing. So they're kind of odd relative to wolves found elsewhere in Canada. We know that at least some Pleistocene wolves were doing the same thing, thanks to the fact that Jure was so beautifully preserved. In my opinion, Alpha does a better job with the animal reconstructions than 10,000 BC. And it might be because my colleague, Dr. Grant Zazula, who is the Yukon paleontologist who works in Whitehorse, was involved in consulting on the various animal reconstructions. Good job, Grant. Now we're gonna look at the movie Ice Age. Here we go. It seems to be a squirrel of some sort that's reconstructed with saber teeth. I think these movies assume that everything that was around in the Pleistocene had to have had saber teeth.
Where's Eddie?
He said something about being on the verge of an evolutionary breakthrough.
Really?
I'm flying!
So they're showing a lot of different animals here migrating together. One of the ones that I wanted to point out were glyptodonts. Glyptodonts are actually relatives of modern sloths, even though they look nothing like that, because these were huge animals with big, hard coverings on their back. Super weird creatures. They don't actually make it up into Canada, but interestingly, were part of the northern migration into North America that was part of the Great American Biotic Interchange. So this is when the Panama Canal finally became a land bridge and allowed animals to move between North and South America. And one of the animals that came north was the glyptodont.
Hey, I'm up!
So I'm not sure what species of sloth Sid is meant to be, but he has three claws on his hands, so I have to assume he's a three-toed sloth. So this would be a member of the genus Bradypus. They were only found in South America, to my knowledge, but in Canada, we actually have a much more interesting sloth, and this is Jefferson's ground sloth, Megalonyx jeffersoni. Megalonyx was found in the Yukon, and it's referred to as a ground sloth. So these were big, massive creatures that may have been about 3 meters long and weighed up to 2,000 pounds. So definitely bigger than Sid. So Megalonyx, their closest living relative was in fact the three-toed sloth. So they were close relatives of Sid, theoretically.
It wouldn't be breakfast without him, especially since his daddy wiped out half our pack.
So Diego is a Smilodon, much like the specimen beside me that we talked about also with 10,000 BC. So they've made a different choice here in terms of the coat color for Diego. If you remember in 10,000 BC, they were either spotted or stripy. Here they've decided to reconstruct Diego as being sort of a tan color. So in fact, we don't know what the coat of Smilodon fatalis would have looked like. So we have to just base it on what we know about modern cats. And we have everything from striped and spotted to tan like lions. So 10,000 BC seems to have gone the sort of leopard approach in terms of how they colored Smilodon. So we know lions, which are ambush predators, and puma, or mountain lions, are also tan color. So this is a reasonable choice, in my opinion. We don't know. And they've gone the puma direction, as it were. Dodos are an interesting choice here. As far as I know, they were only ever found on an island called Mauritius in the Indian Ocean. So it's an interesting choice with regards to biogeography. I've stopped it here because you can see a little bit more about his teeth. And I wanted to point out firstly that if he is a three-toed sloth, Bradypus, he would not have had buck teeth. But the teeth farther back in his mouth actually do look a little more accurate. Both the ground sloth, Megalonyx jeffersoni, which is found in Canada, and modern sloths have similar peg-like teeth. And they're quite different from other mammals in the sense that they have a very simple shape. Sid has now come across what looks like one of those sort of classic evolutionary sequences, but it's for the sloth. It's hilarious and not at all accurate, I suspect. But what's interesting is that the third creature appears to be an aquatic sloth. So this is actually something that did exist. There is an aquatic sloth called Thalaxinus. They went extinct prior to the Ice Age, and they were found only in South America. Well, how do we know that they were swimming? So part of that evidence comes from analysis of the forelimbs. And so certain characteristics of the hand and the radius and ulna and the humerus suggest that it could have been using its forelimbs kind of like a paddle. So super weird for a sloth. The final sloth in this sequence appears to be using its forelimbs and walking on its knuckles for locomotion. I think they probably mean this to make a reference to some sort of caveman, but surprisingly, this is actually accurate to what a ground sloth like Megalonyx would have been doing. Because they had these big claws on their forelimbs, they did probably use their knuckles to walk. Well, it's been a lot of fun looking at these movies and seeing how various studios and directors have decided to reconstruct some of these animals. It's clear that movies that have had the most input from scientists have the most accurate reconstructions. And so the more that scientists get involved in Hollywood movies, I think we're going to see more amazing reconstructions like we see in the movie Alpha, for example. I don't get to do this at home because it annoys my partner when I pause the movie and comment on whether the animal is moving accurately or whether they look really lifelike or are accurate to what we know about fossils. So I got a chance to do this today and had a really great time.